Driving cars, riding a bike, walking up a mountain, and even ironing a shirt. All these and many other trivial daily activities have their extreme counterpart as people take them out of their normal context and redefine the essence of the activity. F1 racing is perhaps the most obvious example as extreme outlet of driving a car, and over the past decade, the Red Bull Corporation has taken all kinds of sport to an extreme level. Just think about the crashed ice, downhill ice skating, or freeride snowboarding. It seems that every activity can be turned into an extreme sport nowadays, including, yes, something as mundane as working with your computer. This extreme sports outlet is called extreme overclocking and involves blowing stuff up as well as liquid nitrogen and blasting blowtorches. The usual extreme, in other words. Over the course of this documentary, we have a look at what this extreme overclocking is all about. Put in the most simple terms possible, overclocking is essentially increasing the performance of computer components by adjusting the operating frequency beyond factory settings. Years ago, overclocking was the main method of making sure your old PC could run the software applications you wanted to use. As computer components are not cheap, for students, overclocking was a common way to circumvent low budgets. A free performance upgrade, if you will. Over the years, innovation after innovation, overclocking lost its practical relevance and the overclocking scene moved on to extreme overclocking. The main goal for these extreme overclockers is no longer to get the free performance upgrade, but just to have the fastest system. And the industry, well, they caught on as well. What once was a small enthusiast community hobby turned into a scene sporting worldwide global competitions supported by leading computer industrials. In September 2012, we attended the world finals of one of these global events called the MSI Master Overclocking Arena. Throughout the weekend, we followed these extreme overclockers and tried to figure out how they turned something as trivial as working with a PC into an extreme sport. For the grand final of their annual Overclocking World Championship, MSI, a well-known brand amongst gamers and PC enthusiasts, flew out 32 extreme overclockers to Taipei, Taiwan. In case you didn't know, Taipei is pretty much the center of computer hardware, as many of the vendors have their headquarters located in the capital of Taiwan. Each of the 16 teams had already survived a regional qualifier, and this proved worthy for the grand final. In this competition, each team receives the same set of hardware. Over the course of 6 hours, the goal is to achieve the best overclocking results. MSI, organizer of this competition, had come up with an intricate formula to rate each team's performance. The formula was based on the percentual gain over a reference score of 3 different benchmarks. A benchmark is a software application designed to measure the performance of a computer system and present it as an easy to compare single figure. We first meet up with the extreme overclockers when they arrive at the hotel. Most of the overclockers know each other from previous competitions and events. Even though this is a real competition, most of the overclockers consider each other more as friends than real adversaries.
Hey guys, when did you arrive?
1 week ago.
1 week ago?
Sure.
Wow, and until when do you stay?
Sure.
Till Sunday.
Wow, cool. Yeah. You had a good trip?
Yeah, awesome. Cool. Many pieces of bini.
Enjoying Taiwan so far?
Love it.
Cool. All right, good luck for tomorrow.
The day after the arrival, the competitors are driven to the National Taiwan University Sports Center venue. We sense that the heartwarming welcome of the previous day slowly changes into a tense competition atmosphere. Some of the competitors are trying to get over the stress by talking complete nonsense.
Same venue.
While others isolate themselves from the group and try to gain focus for the competition. Finally, the green light is given and the extreme overclockers make their way into the venue. As they enter, a line of bystanders is giving them a real superstar welcome, forming an honor guard and cheering loudly. Once the master judge of the competition has gone over the rules and details, the overclockers pick up their components and start preparing their configurations. It's a feeling like you never know. To be able to use computer components for extreme overclocking, they need to undergo a special treatment. This procedure is necessary to protect the components from early burnout due to temperature or condensation problems. Every overclocker has their own way of preparing the system for extreme overclocking. Some prefer Vaseline, others choose artistic eraser or an insulation foam called Armaflex. When asking the competitors which is the best way to prepare the system, we get about 32 different answers. In the end, it all seems to come down to personal preference and perhaps even superstition. In any case, the preparation is a critical part of the competition. Condensation is an extreme overclocker's worst enemy. It can cause hardware failure, and that means an early retire from the competition. After an hour of intense preparation, the contest can finally kick off. The competition is split up in three stages. The first stage is 1.5 hours long and is centered around the SuperPi 32M benchmark. This benchmark mainly stresses the processor, implicating that the main focus of this round is the processor frequency. The benchmark calculates the Pi number to 32 million decimals. The less time needed to complete the calculation, the better you rank. Many hardcore overclockers have a soft spot for this almost mythical benchmark, as it's been around since the beginning of modern overclocking. The second part of the competition requires a completely different skill set, as we move focus from the processor to the graphics card. This benchmark is called 3D Mark 03, and although it's been around for 9 years now, it's still challenging enough to be relevant in an extreme overclocking competition. Given its age and the way the benchmark code was written, 3D Mark 03 is no longer a pure graphics card benchmark, but has evolved into a system benchmark where you need both processor as well as graphics card computing power. The competition concludes with a 3-hour session of the latest 3D benchmark called 3D Mark 11. This benchmark features all the latest technologies used in modern games and is therefore very much graphics card dependent. As we're in the final stretch of the competition, the extreme overclockers are starting to push their components to the absolute maximum. They try to squeeze every last bit of performance out of their mainboard, processor or graphics card. Usually, in this phase of the competitions, most competitors drop out by either having hardware failure or just quitting, as the top spots are out of reach. This kind of competition usually features 12 to 20 teams, but of those teams, only a select few actually compete for the top rankings. After the first round at the Master Overclocking Arena, only 5 teams were still in the race for gold. After the second stage, 3 teams were still in the race, being separated by only 0.15%. In the end, the Korean team dominated the 3 stages and became the first Asian team to win the grand final of an extreme overclocking competition since 2008. Team USA finished second, Team Poland third. It's at this point in the competition that we realize that even though extreme overclocking competitions have been around since 2006, they haven't really evolved into a proper sport yet. Looking back at what we experienced during that weekend, it's the little details that give away how much room there still is for improvements. A couple of examples. The format of the competition hasn't changed much since the first contest back in 2006. Also, just like at any other extreme overclocking event we attended before, there is still a vast lack of interest from the mainstream media. There was no coverage from local TV teams, let alone international press. In fact, few attending media had any questions prepared for the interviews. Also, the $3,000 cash prize for the winners is very low compared to what gamers receive for winning a couple of rounds of Counter-Strike. Actually, that $3,000 prize is for most participants not even enough to cover the cost of qualifying. Note that we are not singling out one particular vendor with our criticism, as the points we brought up apply to every single extreme overclocking competition organized since 2006. It seems that although many overclockers, as well as the industry, like to present themselves as overclocking professionals, they remain stuck in a scene that is in desperate need of innovation and creativity to push it to the next level. All this lack of interest is actually quite contrasting with what we've seen at major IT events, where extreme overclocking demonstrations usually attract quite a lot of audience. Those demonstrations prove that there is definitely potential for a larger target audience. Perhaps it's time for the key players in the overclocking scene to sit down and work out a concept that benefits the overclockers, the industry, the audience, as well as the media. It's quite certain that this hobby or sport does not have the potential to grow as big as F1 racing, but it definitely has the potential to attract more audience outside of the extreme overclocking enthusiast community. Nevertheless, the members of the Extreme Overclocking Competition all very much appreciate MSI's effort to push and support extreme overclocking through the Master Overclocking Arena competitions. And truth be told, having organized this competition for 5 years straight now, MSI can truly be called a pioneer in competitive extreme overclocking.
Do you know how to dance Gangnam Style?
I know.
Many pieces of vinyl. What's going on?